Allah la ilaha illa hu lahul asma husna. It means the same thing. There is no God worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once again, all the beautiful names belong to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeats this at least four times in the Quran. I'm going to share three of those ayats with you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Isra, the 17th surah, in ayah number 110. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قُلِ اِذُوَ اللَّهُ أَوِدُوا الرَّحْمَنِ أَيَّامًا مَا تَدْءُوا فَلَهُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, call upon Allah or call upon Him as most merciful. Call Him Allah or call Him Rahim. All the beautiful names belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are many cases in which the Quran repeatedly asserts this. And as a result of that, we have paid a lot of attention. For those of you who know what this is what is casually mentioned as tasbih. We use this as an instrument for counting and memorizing and doing zikr. It has 99 beads in it. Remember, when you're buying, if it has 108, then it belongs to the Buddhist. The shorter one is always the Muslim's one, 99 beads, excluding this one. So why do we have 99? You're familiar with SubhanAllah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, you do 33, 33, and 34. But one of the reasons why this has 99 beads in it is because of this famous hadith by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. He says, indeed Allah has 99 names, 100 less one. Whoever counts them shall enter paradise. So Abu Huraira says, may Allah be pleased with him, says that he heard Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 99 names. Main ahsaha dakhala jannah. And whoever, the word ahsaha is very interesting. Whoever counts it, or whoever remembers it, or whoever understands, loves, and finds meaning in this. There are other hadiths. There's one in which, again recorded by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, Allah has 99 names, 100 minus 1, and whoever believes in their meaning and acts according to them, Allah is witr, and He loves the odd number. Witr is one or odd, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one, and therefore He likes odd numbers, and therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 99 names, and He says, whoever remembers all these names will inshallah go to Jannah. And this is a hadith, it is a recognized hadith, so I don't know if it is enough for us to remember the 99 names of Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but this is an ihkam, this is from the Sharia. There are people who follow the hadith which says that if somebody memorizes the Quran, 50 members of their family will go to heaven, and so they make the children memorize the Quran, but it does the hard work, and the rest of the 50 people go to Jannah. This is much more easier than that. You don't have to put somebody else to do the hard work for you. You can do it yourself. Memorize the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names has power in them. For example, you cannot pray your salah without doing wudu. And you cannot do wudu without saying bismillah. Remember that if you do not say bismillah before doing wudu, the wudu is not valid. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this in more than one hadith. This is how he said it. Without wudu, there is no salah, and without bismillah, there is no wudu. The idea of wudu is about becoming purified. And it is not just physical purification. Because if physical purification was alone required, then we wouldn't have taimum, where we actually add more dust. Rather than clean ourselves of dirt, we actually end up adding dirt when we do things. Purification is a symbolic exercise in which we physically clean ourselves, that is the minimum, but we also spiritually clean ourselves to become ready to be in the presence of God. You don't want to be dirty, you don't want to be stinking, smelly. That's why there are so much adab about coming to Jummah Salah, about bathing, about adding perfume, about wearing fresh clothes, about clean clothes. These are all parts of purification, but the real magic that purifies us come from the invocation of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, your name, the invoking name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purifies things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names by themselves have a spiritual impact. They purify you. There's an interesting hadith reported by Aisha radiallahu anha. She says that some Bedouin people used to bring us meat. This is in Surah An-Nasa'i. She said there were some Bedouins who used to bring meat to us. And somebody says, we do not know whether this is Zabiha or halal meat. They didn't know these were Bedouins. They used to bring it for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Messenger of Allah said, mention the name of Allah and eat. So when Aisha radiallahu anha said, I don't know whether this meat is halal. You know, we make a big deal in America about Zabiha meat. Even in masjid, sometimes it's difficult to order pizza because some people say that even chicken pizza may not be halal, etc. The Prophet ﷺ said, say the name of this meal I need because it has a purifying effect. The reason why we invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, when we sacrifice an animal is for the purification of the thing that we will eat. But it is enough, at least from this hadith, when the Prophet says. So we have to understand that the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has powerful impact. It has this purifying effect. When the Quran says names, the word ism, you must understand it is not the way we use the word name. For example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, he said he taught Adam the names of things. It doesn't mean he said, okay, this is a mic and this is a paper and this is a phone and this is a room. That's not what he taught Adam. Angels know this. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran to the angels, you don't know what I know. One of the things was that he taught Adam the names of things. What does it mean to know the names of things? It's very important for us to understand this because these are very deep aspects of Islam, its spirituality and its mysticism. For example, this place, this Mekan that we are in at the moment, is Masjid Isa ibn Maryam. So if someone says, where are you going? And I say to some Muslim brother from Melbourne, I'm going to Isa ibn Maryam. He won't know where I'm going. He might say jokingly, are you going to church? I said, no, I said Isa ibn Maryam. So it could be an Islamic school. He could guess. He has three or four choices because Muslims have only two or three things in America. The Islamic schools, madrasas, and halal meat stores. So it could be one of the three. So Isa ibn Maryam does not mean anything by itself. It is nominal, we call it. But if I said I'm going to Masjid Isa ibn Maryam, then he understands the nature of the place that I'm going to. So I'm going to a masjid, I'm going to a mosque where I will pray, where sajda is done. The place where you do sujood is masjid. And then if I just said I'm going to a masjid, he'll understand the nature of the place, but not the specificity of the place. So when I say to somebody in Delaware, I'm going to Masjid Isa ibn Maryam, they understand that I'm going to a masjid, and it is not Masjid al-Kawthar, but it is Masjid Isa ibn Maryam, attached to Tarjah. So that is how specificity. So when you say masjid, we define the essence of the place. When we say Isa ibn Maryam, we are distinguishing it from other such places. But na'uzubillah, when you take the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are not distinguishing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from any other laysa ka mislihi. There is nobody else but Allah. So Allah's name do not distinguish him from other gods because there are no other gods. So what do these names do? They are like the name masjid. They describe the essence and the nature of the thing that is named. That is why we say in Muslim traditions that when you name your children, think very carefully. Because you're not saying, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, or X, Y, Z, but you're saying Majid, Rajid, Zahid, Rashid. When you give these names, we hope that that person becomes the meaning of that name. And the person becomes the meaning of that name. So you try to build that character. So the name, the ism, is a description of nature. It prescribes to you the nature of the thing that is named. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Adam alayhi salam the names of things, he basically taught him the size of existence. When he said planet, he doesn't say this is a planet. He tells you what a planet is. And that is important. So when we look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names, then we begin to understand how there are so many things attached to his name. Maulana Jalaluddin Rumi in his poetry says something very fascinating. He says two things. One, he says, and I'm just going to read the translation, my Persian is not good enough to be introduced in public. With us, the name of everything is outward appearance. With us, the name of everything is outward appearance. With the Creator, the name of each thing is its inward reality. So when we name things, sometimes it is upward. We call people, oh, the tall guy. It's external appearance. We don't know whether he's honest or not. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, names are reflections of the inner reality of things. In the eyes of Moses, the name of his rod was staff. In the eyes of the Creator, the name was dragon. Because that is what the staff did. It ate up all the other things that other magicians were proving. In brief, that which we are in the end is our real name with God. Now this is where he goes really profound in the idea of naming. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at us, is he saying Mustada or is he saying Mu'min? Na'udhubillah, rebel. I don't want him to look at me and see a rebel. I don't want him to look at me and see a denier. I want him to look at me and assume that yes, he is, if not a Muhsin, at least a Mu'min, if not a Mu'min, at least a Muslim, inshallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at us, and the names that are given are the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's how we know. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to some ahadith, has 99 names. But remember, this is not from the Quran, it comes from one tradition. And in fact, the 99 names that we think are 99 names are some that Abu Huraira has collected, the Sahabi, based on the hadith that he himself reports that the Prophet said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 99 names. But the general consensus among scholars and the Sahaba is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has infinite names, because all the beautiful names belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, some scholars actually believe that the best of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names are not known to humanity, that we do not know the greatest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we count the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from Ar-Rahman to As-Subur, we do not count Allah. Allah is not one of the 99 names of. So what is Allah? It is not a generic term. In one tradition, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, for him who is ignorant and illiterate, knowing the name Allah is enough. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's every name signifies one aspect of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Says he's Ar-Rahman, that means he's merciful, he's Ar-Rahim, he's benevolent, he's Al-Malik, Al-Hakim, he's ruler, etc. All of these qualities are part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the name Allah is the essence of all of these names. So remember, you can say that Rahman is also a name of Allah. As-Salam is also a name of Allah. Al-Bari is also a name of Allah. But you cannot say that Ar-Rahman is also the name of As-Salam. It's very interesting, isn't it? So what it really means is that Allah is the core of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's identity. And all these names then introduce us to various characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rahman, is forgiving. Even in forgiveness, if you go there at least three or four different names, you have Ghaffar, you have Ghafur, of all. He is a forgiver, he is a repeat forgiver, he often forgives, and so on. So this is something important for us to remember about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names, that we get to know him. It is by knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names that we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we fall in love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine this, you know, I don't know how many of you have been fortunate enough to be in love. But I hope that most of you, the adults at least, are married and you love. And those of you who have children are loved by your parents. And if you notice that you may have names, and then your parents will call you by other names. For example, my son's name is Muhammad Abdul Rahim Khan. It's a big name. In India and Pakistan, people have nicknames. Like, for example, your son could be named Abdullah. So you can't say, Abdullah, come here, I will treat you to some third degree, because you're using the name of Allah. So you have nicknames which have meaninglessness. And so you can say, okay, I will spank you so-and-so. So I call my son Rumi, but this name is out of endearment, out of affection, out of intimacy. So with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you want to develop a relationship of affection, of love, you have to get to know him in all his different natures. Know him as Rahman, know him as Rahim. He's an expander. He's also someone who contracts. He's something that is manifest, zahir. He's something that is hidden, batin. He's the first al-awwal, he's also the last lap. Both Rumi and another important Andalusian Shaykh, Ibn Arabi, said something very interesting about the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which I found simply mind-blowing. I could not understand what Ibn Arabi meant when he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names are essentially names of relationships. These are not names, but these are the relationships. I could not understand that until I read a poem in Masnavi by Rumi, and this is what Rumi says about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names. He says, just as a person is in relation to you, a father, and in relation to another, either son or brother, so the names of Allah have relations. He is from the viewpoint of the infidel and the tyrant, Khahar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name is Al-Khahar, which means he is a subduer. He overpowers. But who does he overpower? He overpowers him or her who rebels. So suddenly when you invoke the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Al-Khahar, what you're talking about is a relationship between Allah and one who disobeys him, one who rebels against him. So this is a relationship. And so Rumi goes on further and said, from our viewpoint, it is Allah is merciful. So if you are a believer, then the relationship that you have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the merciful, the Rahman. That is the relationship. That's why nearly every surah of the Quran begins with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, because that is the relationship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to establish with those who read the Quran. One of compassion and one of... When I read this and I understood what Ibn Arabi was saying, I suddenly realized that to me the most dearest name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from now on should be Al-Ghafoor and Al-Ghafar, the most forgiving. He was forgiving because I think I received a lot of forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So suddenly I have a clarity now at the moment in this stage in my life, in this stage in my spiritual development, what relationship I need from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think I've committed lots of sins, and so I need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. But Ibn Arabi goes even further, and he says something very profound. He says, not only are all these names relationships, but they are something that talab, he uses the word talab. Talab means desire or even demand creation. Well, that is very difficult, so I will try and explain it in 1 or 2 minutes and see if it works. If it works, it doesn't. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Mu'iz, the bestower of honors, but he's also Al-Mubil, the humiliator. So Allah Ta'ala is a humiliator. But when does Allah Ta'ala becomes the humiliator? Only when there is somebody who deserves to be humiliated. I know one such person who lives about 115 miles from here. Okay? Who deserves to be humiliated. So what happens is when you have these all these names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are aspects of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's personality, are aspects of his nature, and they always existed and will always exist. These that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the humiliator, was Al-Qahhar even before he created the creation. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Khaliq. He is the creator. He was the creator before the creation existed. So what does it mean that he is a creator? What is he a creator of? Certain Arabs arguing that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Khaliq, there is a creation, because the creation demanded its existence because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's nature as the creator. Now that's a very difficult thing to understand, because we're talking about the necessity of creation from the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. During the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina, there used to be many masajid, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam appointed one sahabi as the imam of that masjid. And that sahabi had a very unique habit. After every time when he read the salah, after Surah Fatiha, he would read Surah Al-Ikhlas, and then he would read another surah. So he would read, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Qul huwa Allahu ahad, say that Allah is one, which I think, La ilaha illallah, Qul huwa Allahu ahad, Allahu samad. Samad is one of the names of Allah. It means he exists by himself. He doesn't need anything to exist. The only thing in, I can't even say in creation, the only thing in existence that exists by itself, without being created, without an end to it, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what As-Samad means. Lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Then he would go around. So some of these people who used to pray behind him and ask him one day, why do you do this? Why do you always recite? The sunnah is one Surah Fatiha and one surah, and you keep reciting two surahs, and why always only full? This sahabi was a little shy, so he said, look, this is my nature, this is what I will do. If you want to pray behind me, pray, otherwise don't. So these members of the masjid went to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, this is what this man is doing. So the Prophet said, go ask him why he is doing that. So when these people came back, now this time empowered with the authority from Rasulullah to ask the same question, he had no answer, but he answered. He said, I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to me, Surah Ikhlas is a description of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It tells me who Allah is. And how can I give it up? How can I give up Surah Ikhlas? Because it tells me who Allah is. This is the entity that I worship. This is the entity I love. This is who created me. How can I not say that? So these people went back to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, this is what he said. And subhanAllah, Rasulullah said, go tell him that because of his recitation of Qul huwa Allahu Ahad, he had entered Jannah. Qul qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Hashr, the 59th surah, the last three ayat, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Huwa Allahu allazi la ilaha illa hu, alimul ghaibi wa shahada wa huwa ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Huwa Allahu allazi la ilaha illa hu, al-Malikul Quddus, as-Salamu al-Mu'minu al-Muhaiminu al-Azizu al-Jabbaru al-Mutakabbir. Subhanallahi amma yushrikun. والله الخالق الباري والمصور له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم. These three ayahs from Surah Al-Hashr, 22-24, include 18 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is very important for us to understand this. You know, many of the ayahs of the, or many of the thoughts that are there in the Quran, often end with Huwa al-Aziz al-Rahim, Huwa al-Aziz al-Hakim, Huwa al-Rahman al-Rahim. And people tend to just read them and move on and pay attention to the rest of the part, because we are so obsessed with ahkam. So we are only looking for rulings and content. We forget. Then why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying these things? He's not saying they're just to make the Quran rhyme. There's always a connection to the rule that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making to the name that He's invoking to authorize it. So it's like saying when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a rule and then He signs off on it, He's signing with different names. So if you notice, wherever He talks about punishment, He always signs off as Rahman and Rahim, implying that He is also forgiving. So it's very important for us when we read Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's book to pay very close attention, especially to the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the only way we know. Otherwise we are stuck with generic terms like God, deity, and go with Webster's definition of God. Is that how you want to know Allah? By reading the word God and then going and checking on your Google what is the meaning of God in Webster. You want Webster to define to you who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. There's so much beauty. These three verses that I recited every night. There's 18 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all in one place. And often in a sequence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prefers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names are very critical. I would encourage all of you to basically look at the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Read what each one of those names means. They are just 99 names. If you don't know this much about our deen, what do we know? I have a cousin, a nephew, Omar, a young kid. When he was 5 or 6 years old, at a school function, he recited all the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and at the end of it, he said, Alhamdulillah, I know all the 99 names of Allah. Even my parents don't know them. So it is important. We try to teach our children these things, but we need to learn ourselves. We need to know the entity that we worship, and we can know them by knowing and reflecting upon the names of Allah. The more you think, like for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He's Al-Razzaq. What does it mean? He's a provider. What does He provide? I can assure you that if you reflect on some of the names, it will transform your philosophy of life and your approach to how you live on earth. Because once you realize that you believe in these aspects of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's existence and His teachings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting. He's Al-Hafiz. If He protects us, we cannot be afraid of anything or anybody. But we have to know and we have to develop that relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us decide this year what relationship we want to really develop with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are a couple more things I want to say on Monday. I know that the people think that these days people are obsessed with bid'ah. The extent to which we are obsessed with bid'ah itself is bid'ah, I think. But make resolutions for 2018. Think about it. Set yourself goals. This is a good time. But set yourself goals which are achievable, which are not too high, and are complex. Don't say at the end of this, I'll be a better Muslim. Well, you're a better Muslim if you have intended that already. But that's not the point. When you say, I'll be a better Muslim, make it operational so you can verify. Like, I will pray more or I will give more. So decide in a very concrete, verifiable thing, like a scientific hypothesis that can be proven or disproven. Write down those goals. Make goals for yourself, personal goals. Make financial goals. I will increase my income by 10%. I will increase my savings by 20%. I will improve my driving. I will ensure. And make sure that you're looking not just at yourself, but also at your family. Look at the material well-being of your family. Look at the spiritual well-being of your family. The legal protections that your family needs. Sit down, take an hour or two, write these goals down. And then pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of you may need to work on your health more than anything else. Look at the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that will make you healthy. Some of you may need money more than anything else. Look at that aspect of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-Ghani. And try to invoke those names. And when you remember, before you sleep, when you do tasbih, remember Allah by those names. رَبَّنَا أَتَيْنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسْنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ وَحَسْنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا وَيُؤْمِنُوا بِهِ Remember Allah with much remembrance. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون وأقيموا الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. يا أيتها النفس المطمئنة ارجعي إلى ربك راضية مرضية فادخلي في عبادي وادخلي جنتي. الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
سمي الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
آمين.
إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر. الله أكبر
الله.
سمي الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر
الله.
الله أكبر
الله.
الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
السلام السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله we have a number of friends and community members traveling to this masjid today from Dubai, from Pakistan, from New Jersey, and probably other areas as well. Please join in and spend some time with us until Asr, inshallah. Asr will be at 2:30. So please stay here, inshallah. Join the program. And some of these members have really good voices, mashallah, and they'll be reciting a few nasheeds. So please join us in this program. Jazakallah.
Assalamu alaikum. As you heard about this special brief program, within a couple of minutes we will be starting that. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليكم. Brothers and sisters, as you heard earlier in khutbah, Brother Muqtada Khan was describing the different attributes of Allah Ta'ala, all the different praises that we can do. Actually, this poem that I wrote a couple of weeks back is also reflecting the same. I'm describing the different aspects of Allah's identity and also saying, in light of those, how insignificant I am. I wrote it in Urdu. I'm going to read it now. The title of this hamd, which is Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Kahan teri zaat-e-ali aur kahan main naachiz. Kahan teri zaat-e-ali aur kahan main naachiz. Main teri hamd karun to kaise karun. मैं तेरी हम्द करूं तो कैसे करूं? ना मेरे पास वो महारत, ना मेरे पास वो महारत, ना मेरे पास वो अल्फाज। मैं तेरी हम्द करूं तो कैसे करूं? तेरी जात जल्ल जलालहू, तेरी जात जल्ल जलालहू, मैं एक जर्रा खाक। मैं तेरी हम्द करूं तो कैसे करूं? तू अजल से है, तू अबद तक रहेगा। तू अजल से है, तू अबद तक रहेगा। मेरी जात तो फानी है, मैं हम तेरी हम्द करूं तो कैसे करूं? तू कायनात की हर शय का मालिक है, तू कायनात की हर शय का मालिक है। मैं तेरे आगे एक मुफलिस, मैं तेरी तारीफ करूं तो कैसे करूं? तेरे इशारे के बगैर एक पत्ता भी हिल न सके। मैं नातवां, मैं बेबस और मजबूर, मैं तेरी हम करूं तो कैसे करूं? अब इसका मतलब है, तेरी सब मखलूकात हर वक्त तेरी हम्द करें। तेरी सब मखलूकात हर वक्त तेरी हम्द करें। ये सोच कर मैं भी सर्वसजदा हो गया, ये सोचकर मैं भी सर्वसजदा हो गया। और फिर मेरे दिल से सदा आने लगी, अल्लाहु अकबर, अल्लाहु अकबर।
بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. جیسا کہ علیر محترم ڈاکٹر صاحب اس میں الہی کے اوپر برکات اور اس کے فضائل کے اوپر گفتگو فرما رہے تھے، الحمدللہ تھوڑی دیر کے لیے دعاؤں کا مجموعہ ہے جس کو ختم خواجگان سے منسوخ کیا جاتا ہے، اس کے کچھ کلمات ہیں، پرانی آیات اور مناجات اور انبیاء علیہ السلام کے وظائف پر مشتمل یہ اوراد ہیں. تمام دوستوں سے گزارش ہے کہ ہمارے ساتھ شامل ہو جائیں. ہاتھ اٹھا کے فاتحہ شریف. بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم، الحمدللہ رب العالمین، الرحمن الرحیم، مالک یوم الدین، ایاک نعبد و ایاک نستعین، اهدنا الصراط المستقیم صراط الذین انعمت علیہم غیر المغضوب علیہم ولا الضالین. آمین. درود پاک صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ وسلم. صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ وسلم. صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ وسلم. سورہ لم نشرح.
بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم.
الم نشرح لك صدرك ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي انقض ظهرك ورفعنا لك ذكرك فإن مع العسر يسرا إن مع العسر يسرا فإذا فرغت فانصب إلى ربك فارغب. سورة إخلاص. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. سورة فاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. درود پاک صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ وسلم. صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ وسلم. آیت کریمہ. لا الہ الا انت سبحانک انی کنت من الظالمین. لا الہ الا انت سبحانک انی کنت من الظالمین. لا الہ الا انت سبحانک انی کنت من الظالمین. درود پاک
صلی اللہ
علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ وسلم. صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ وسلم. صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ وسلم. کلمہ طیبہ. لا الہ الا اللہ. لا الہ الا اللہ. لا الہ الا اللہ. محمد رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم. یا اللہ
یا عزیز
یا ودود
یا
کریم یا وہاب
یا
حی یا قیوم
حسبنا
اللہ ونعم الوکیل نعم المولا ونعم النصیر. اللهم يا قاضي الحاجات
يا
دافي البليات
يا
أهل
المشكلات
يا كافي المهمات
يا
شافي الأمراض
يا
منزل البركات يا مسبب الأسباب
يا
رافع الدرجات
يا
مجيب الدعوات
يا
أمان الخائفين
يا
يا خير الناصرين
يا
دليل المتحيرين
يا
غياث المستغيثين أغثنا
يا
مفرح المحزونين
يا مفرح المحزونين
ربي إني مغلوب فانتصر يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا ارحم الراحمين سوئم کلمہ سبحان اللہ الحمد للہ ولا الہ الا اللہ واللہ اکبر ولا حول ولا قوت الا باللہ العلی العظیم اللہم استرنی بسترک الجمیل درود پاک صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد وآلہ وصحابہ وسلم صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد وآلہ وصحابہ وسلم صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد وآلہ وصحابہ وسلم اللہم ربنا آمین 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 برحمتک یا ارحم الراحمین. چند منٹ کے لیے ذکر الہی کریں گے, تمام دوست میرے ساتھ شامل ہو جائیں, کوئی دوست جو ہے وہ خاموش نہ رہے. لا الہ الا اللہ
لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ
محمد رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم الا 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 محمد رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم سبحانی میاں الخیری صاحب جو دبئی سے تشریف لائے ہیں, آپ حضرات کے سامنے جو ہے وہ حمد باری تعالیٰ پیش فرمائیں گے.
Allah باپ کے چند اشعار پیش کرتے ہیں. سارے دوست مل کے پڑھیے.
صلی اللہ علیہ یا رسول اللہ وسلم علیک یا حبیب اللہ. تو کو جا مر کو جا تو کو جا من کو جا دستار باندھے ہوئے کعبہ آئے عشق تو میں تیرے چرسوں کا بھائی عشق تو میں تیرے چرسوں تو اثر میں دعا تو کجا میں کجا تو کجا میں کجا مولا یا سلیم سلیم دائما ابدا علی حبیبک خیر الخلق کلهم مولا یا سلیم سلیم دائما ابدا علی حبیبک محمد سید القومین والفقرین والفریقین من عرب ومن عجم مولا یا صلی وسلم دائما ابدا علی حبیبک خیر الخلق کلهم هو الحبیب الذی ترجا شفاعته هو الحبیب الذی ترجا شفاعته لكل حول من الاحوال مقتره
السلام علیکم یا مجھ کو ملا پتہ है खड़े
رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا حبيب الله. يا الله ہم سب کی اس حاضری کو اپنی بارگاہ میں شفع قبول عطا فرما، یا اللہ ہم سب کے صغیرہ کبیرہ گناہ معاف فرما، آئندہ نیک عمل کرنے کی توفیق عطا فرما، بھائی نوید صاحب کے انہوں نے جس طرح یہاں اہتمام کیا اللہ تعالیٰ ان کے کام میں برکت عطا فرما، یا اللہ سب دوستوں کی مشکلات دور فرما، ہماری بہنیں مائیں بچے بھی موجود ہیں اللہ ان کی ساری تکالیف دور فرما، جن دوستوں نے بھی یہاں جس انداز سے یہاں اہتمام کرتے ہیں اللہ ان کے کاروبار میں علم میں عمل میں اضافہ فرما، اس پورے علاقے پر اللہ تعالی رحمت و نزول فرما، انصرنا فإنك خیر الناصرین، وافتح لنا فإنك خیر الفاتحین، وارزقنا فإنك خیر الرازقین، واحفظنا فإنك خیر الحافظین، واهدنا ونجنا من القوم الظالمین، صلی اللہ تعالی علی خیر خلقه سیدنا و مولانا محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ اجمعین، آمین برحمتک یا ارحم الراحمین.